Good morning. Delighted to see you all this morning, and I'm very happy to be able to introduce two fascinating literary personalities from mainland China. On my right, on my near right here, I have Ning, who's best introduced perhaps as a cultural entrepreneur or even a Renaissance man. He has expertise in a quite dazzling range of cultural forms, including architecture, design, curating, poetry, which I believe was his first love, and publishing and editing. And I've probably forgotten of at least 12 of his hidden talents there. One of his most recent ventures is to start up a new literary magazine in Chinese called Tianlan, or Chutzpah in English, and it also carries a translation supplement in English, and I hope to be speaking to him about that later. So am I speaking loud enough for the back? Great. And then at the opposite end of the row here, we have Chen Xiwo, who, to my mind, is one of the most challenging and controversial writers working in China today. He was born in the 1960s, I believe, so he grew up through the Cultural Revolution. He studied literature at university in the 1980s and then went abroad at the end of that decade and spent years in Australia and Japan. Then came back to China in the late 1990s and started teaching comparative literature at a university in southeast China. Because of the challenging nature of a lot of his writing, he had difficulty getting published during the 80s. But after he returned to China, he found a following on the internet. And he then won notoriety, really, in China in 2007 for suing the Chinese government for confiscating and banning one of his stories called I Love My Mum, which is a short fiction about incest and matricide. And so the whole incident, I think, highlighted, amongst many things, the opaqueness and the randomness of the way in which China's censorship system operates. And I hope also that we'll get to talk to Chen Xiwo about that later. But I'd like to start with a very general question to both Ning and Chen Xiwo. As anybody who's gone to China knows, Chinese culture today is in a very fluid state. The norms and fashions change very often and very dramatically. And people working in Chinese literature, they also switch professions very regularly. So writers very easily seem to become filmmakers or businessmen or advertisers or racing car drivers or bloggers, really, at the drop of a pen. And Ning, of course, is a good example of someone who manages to work in several cultural forms at the same time. And yet, what interests me is that both of you, despite this fluidity, both of you have persisted in working in literature. In fact, Ning, you've returned to literature after having spent many years working in the visual arts. Could both of you then tell me, why do you think people in China still write literature rather than making TV, rather than doing business or making films or doing something else entirely? What can you do in fiction or poetry that you cannot do in other cultural forms in China today? Ning.
Okay. Just as Julie said, today China is a very busy country because the new economy creates a lot of opportunity for everybody. So from the intellectual to the ordinary people are both very busy. But I started writing poetry when I was 16 years old, and then after the university, I started to make some underground publication. Then I taught myself graphic design. After that, I became a filmmaker make a documentary film about the urban village in Guangzhou and the slum and in Beijing. Then I got an invitation to participate in the Venice Biennale. Then I became an artist. So I met maybe I wear too many hats, but I'm not doing many things at the same time. So after I do many things, I decide to come back to the literature scenes because I believe my basis ability is thinking and writing. And I come back for the literature to found a literature magazine, not because the literature magazine can make money. And so I have this idea to come back. Then and because you know there's a lot of young Chinese writers, they found literature magazine and show very good, very popular. Then my box want to do this, and at the same time I just want to come back to the literature scene. I have the same idea. Then we start to working on this magazine.
Yeah. 因此规范也不同，时尚也不断变化。那么还有写作，作家，他们变成做电影的人，或者商人，广告人，赛车手，赛车手等等。那么欧敏算是一个很好的例子，因为他在谈论文化的领域做不同的事情。Julia，他认为很有趣的是，你们两位还。 从事写作这一块，那么像他想问一下，人们在中国为什么继续写作，而不是做电视剧啊，或者是商等等，在写作和写诗这一方面，这有没有什么独特的事情？这首先一个就可能是中国变化比较厉害，多元的文化多元的。
几十年前，大家可能希望从文学作品中间来了解社会，甚至传递一种政治上的一种声音，那现在已经不需要了。
The first reason why so many people are interested in doing literature is it's true that today China's society is constantly changing and we have a very diverse culture. However, maybe a few decades ago, it was different. We used culture in order to understand society and in order to promote traditions, but that's already changed.
在中国至少在四九年之后，文学就不是纯文学，它很多时候是承载了一种宣传。And
then maybe 19 years later, the purpose of doing literature is not for art or for literature itself. It's in order to send your own message, or you have an extra meaning.
它一旦不存在这种任务，因此它整个在社会上的重量也会减轻掉。Since
it's no longer for art itself, then the reason that it's then its importance also changes.
那我讲的这宣传实际上是有官方宣传，而实际上我们真正的写作应该传达自己的思想，而这种思想是很困难的，它仍然是处在被控制中间。
What I'm trying to say here is at some points, literature was controlled by the government, and so only certain ideas could come out. And it's very difficult to say your own ideas. This means that there's a lot of control into what you could actually say.
因此写作，就文学写作，它不仅不能够得到很多的现实的好处，很多时候还会招来祸害。
So at this point, literature can't do all the things that it should do, and it can't have all the positive things that you have, sometimes it's even harmful.
所以我很多写作的朋友，实际上他们是不写作的，就要么他们就顺从的现在的很多的就禁忌，顺从就被他们的禁忌所规范去写作，要么他们就干脆就不写了。So
a lot of my friends who are writers have stopped writing. Either they're focused more on what the market wants, and they only write certain things that can sell, or they stop writing entirely.
当然，我自己本人还在写，而且我非常敬重现在还在写作的一些朋友。But
I continue to write, and some of my friends are surprised by this.
Thank you.
Oh, Ning, I'd like to ask you about your magazine, Qianlan. That's quits very in English, as I mentioned. Anybody who works in China knows that there is already a plethora of literary magazines in China, far more, in fact, than there are in the UK or the US. Given that there was already so much competition, Oh Ning, what did you want to do that was new or different with Qianlan?
When I decided to make this literature magazine, I made a research about the Chinese literature magazine, but at the same time also the English literature magazine. I think, for example, People's Literature and Harvest were the two important literature magazines with long history. And both of these two magazines was funded by the government. So I think they have to have a political collection for the government sometimes. But what I want to do actually to trying to invent a new wave of the literature production. How to produce literature, and so the difference is Husker is a Yiddish work. It means you have got to do something different. So I want to at the very beginning I want to, this should be an intellectual magazine, just something like M plus One from New York, and at the same time I also it is a curated magazine. So every issue have a theme. And so it's like Grand Time. And we have very strong interest in politics. That is why every issue we have very serious topic. Sometimes it's academic topic. But all the contributors need to talking about this topic in a literature way, not in academic way. That is why we for example, the first issue is about how the Asia intellectual left the city, moved to the countryside to start the rural reconstruction movement. And the update issue is focus on the revolution. We're talking about the history of the leftist and the anarchist. How to organize the anti-capitalism movement from the past 20 years. So from a visual style, I also would like to make something totally new. I use architectural structure to organize the contents. For example, we have entry, special space, regular space, entrance mainly public porches, and special space mainly for the curated content with the theme, and the free space for the article and fictions which have no connection with the theme. And so we also call the English companion as a parasite. So I'm using the architectural idea to organize the contents, which is very different from the traditional editor. So also the graphic design for the magazine, I like the traditional magazine very much. The full text, all the text, no image. I like this very much. But for the text, we spend a lot of time to design the form, the very detailed things to make it easy for reading. So I think this is a different thing.
And these magazines are beautiful objects, they're beautifully produced. Just a moment ago you raised this interesting question, I think, of the possible political influence on the traditional state-funded magazines. I should point out that an important difference with Oning's magazine is that it's entirely privately funded, as I understand, by one of China's greatest, sort of most important media moguls, a man called Xiao Zhong, or Thomas Xiao. Does the fact that the money is private mean that you have more editorial freedom than the state-run magazines such as People's Literature? What stories can you tell that the older, more traditional magazines can't?
Yes, because it was a private magazine, it invests by a private company, so we have more freedom to edit content. But in China, whatever you did in the publication, you have always to face the censorship. But you know, when I organized the issues on the revolution, I would like to get the Wuhan protests involved in this issue, because this is a very important political event last year. Actually, it happened in a small village, but respond to the global revolution from Africa to Occupy Wall Street movement. But when I write an essay about the Wuhan protest, and we also have a report about it, then in our office there's an old man who in charge of the cell sensors, because the company want the magazine have a long life. They don't want to be touched some sensitive issue and then be cancelled by the government. So I could not actually the Wuhan protest piece could not be published. It's a very pity, because I have a global we have a global vision of the revolution. We also want to share some local Chinese political experience that will become a good opinion for the readers. But it is pity we could not get the Chinese issues involved.
So I'm sure you all know what the Wuhan protests were at the end of last year, but they were this quite extraordinary incident, I think, in local Chinese politics, where a Chinese village in the south of the country effectively threw out their party leadership, just chased them out of the village, blockaded the village until the local authorities stepped down, I think, and allowed the village to hold their own quasi-democratic elections, although I'm not sure whether those have happened yet. Thank you, Oning. Chen Xiwo, as I mentioned in my introduction to you, you are famous, or perhaps infamous, for having taken the Chinese state to court over its decision to ban your book back in 2007. Could you explain why you decided to do this and what you wanted to achieve? After all, many books in China have been banned over the last 3 decades, not to mention the last 3 millennia, in fact. And as far as I know, no Chinese writer has actually decided to sue the Chinese state for banning their books. So I'm just interested in why you decided to do this and what you wanted to show or achieve.
中国是自从事件之后，很多的作家的作品都被禁止了。这个禁止呢，在毛泽东时代是更厉害，就是可能会危及到作家本人的生命安全。现在的话，可能是这种情况是不会，至少比较少。但是的话，这种禁止的这种审查制度仍然是存在的。
It's true that books in China have been banned for a very long time, and during the period of Mao Zedong, it was even more grave and even more serious. At that time, writers had to fear for their own personal safety. Today, writers don't usually have to fear for their own safety, but it's still a very serious issue.
也因此呢，很多人对我不了啊，不理解。他认为说，像过去的年代，可能你的生命都会受到危险，都会蹲监狱。那现在只是把你输进去的话，你就应该的话就接受了，就不要再去起诉他了。So
many people they told me, they're like, I really don't understand you, Chen Xiwo. In the past, you would have gone to prison, and this time they just take your books. You should be happy and not bother them.
也因此呢。 很多作家，我一些很好的作家朋友都不支持我。我记得北京有一家媒体，在对这个事情就请这些作家来替我说话的时候，没有除了《人年科》，没有一个人为我说话。And
thus, a lot of my friends said they didn't support me. They didn't support what I was doing. Some Beijing media outlets decided to interview other writers about the issue and see what other writers thought. But nobody, except for one writer, was able to say what I was doing or why I was doing it.
但是我觉得一个作家的生跟死，他是跟他作品联系在一块的。他即使他本人生命不受到威胁，但是他作品受到威胁，他应该像母亲一样保护自己的孩子。In
my opinion, my identity is tied to my work, and therefore, even if I'm not personally harmed, I will still be worried if my own works are harmed. It's like it's my own child. It's very important to me.
而且，世界潮流发展到现在，我觉得也应该我们做一些努力了，因为现在已经不是毛泽东的时代了。如果我们不努力，也许我们永远不能改变现状。如果努力了，可能这个尺度会被我们越来越拓宽。I
also think that it's time for some change. We need to continue our efforts in opening freedom in China. If we don't ever try to challenge the system, then we'll never achieve change. But if we try to challenge the system, then maybe ultimately it'll be a more open system.
但是付出的代价也是很惨烈的，因为，我这个人，比如说我在出境，我就不是那么容易了。However,
there are costs for acting like this. Now it's more difficult for me to travel.
然后的话，我的官司也打输了，肯定是输了。And
of course, my case, I lost the suit. That was to be expected.
你们知道怎么我怎么输了吧？
Do you know how I lost?
我向法院提出了起诉，因为最初他们是告诉我说这本书是禁书，然后我问他们说，禁书的理由是什么？他们回答我是国家机密。And
it was quite interesting. I took the book to court, and they said that my book was banned. I wanted to ask them why it was banned. They said, I'm sorry, that's classified.
然后我就起诉到法院，大家知道中国司法制度是不独立的，它是听政府，我们的政法委告诉法院说，这个案件不能够公开审理，因为他们怕媒体来报道。And
so at that point, I took it to another court. But as you may know, the courts are tied to government. So the government contacted the court and said, this particular case can't be publicly announced and can't be discussed publicly.
所以那天在法庭上，就是除了我跟我的律师之外，还有就是被告，还有就是审判长。So
on the day of the case, I was present, my wife, and the party which I accused, and that was it.
然后我问被告，我说你为什么禁我的书？你讲出理由来。他回答说，国家机密，我不能告诉你，我已经告诉法院了。And
so at that point, I asked the accused party, why did you ban my book? And he said, I'm sorry, this is classified information.
然后我就问审判长，我说那你能不能告诉我，为什么禁我的书？他说这是国家机密，也不能告诉你。And
then I asked the censor, the person responsible for doing censorship, I said, why is my book being banned? He said, I'm sorry, it's classified information.
然后审判就结束了，因为我的律师再也讲不出什么了。And
at that point, the case was over because my lawyer had nothing to say.
我又告到高级人民法院，仍然是这种情况。那一次我是律师都不叫，我知道是这种情况，结果就我一个人当律师，我就当我的律师。And
then I took the case to a higher court, and at that point I didn't even ask a lawyer to help me. I was my own lawyer because I knew it was kind of pointless to hire a lawyer.
后来我一再纠缠他，我说你好歹总要告诉我理由吧。 然后他说实际上他有一个鉴定书，那个鉴定书是由国家新闻出版总署发出的，但是他国家新闻出版总署告诉他说不要给被告看。
And I just kept pestering them. I'm like, why? Just tell me why this is being banned. Finally, they told me that there was a book that the censorship agency, the General Administration for Press and Publication, has, which kind of lists reasons why books would be banned. And he was explicitly told that Chen Xiwo could not have that information.
然后呢，他就说，那好，他被我纠缠没办法。他说，那好，我念，你不要记，你就听一下就行了。
And then.Finally, they told me they would read the book to me, and I was allowed to hear, but I wasn't allowed to take any notes.
然后用极快的速度说了，我大概听到了，就说它反映了人性的黑暗，然后它是黄色隐晦，它会导致青少年犯罪。
And then they spoke at a ridiculously fast rate of all the reasons.And first they said that it was not helpful to humanity, and they said that it was obscene or erotic. And finally they said that my book would probably affect, it would influence young people to do bad things.
我说这原来 这就叫做国家机密啊。然后的话呢，我就问他一些问题，因为如果是国家机密，它涉及到中国的保密法。中国的保密法是50年代、60年代制定的，就上世纪50年代、60年代制定的。那当初的情况跟现在大不一样了，但是就是按那个保密法，我问他，我说那他的密集就机密的级别是什么？第二个涉及的机密的范围是什么？第三个什么时候解密？他们都答不出来。
And I was very surprised. I was like, how could this be classified? How could this be considered classified information? If this is classified, then it should be still relegated by law. And we're not living in the 50s and 60s anymore. This is a different era. So I asked further questions. I asked them, what level of classification is this? And to what extent is it classified? And what areas are classified and what aren't? And finally, when will the classification be lifted?When will it be open again? They weren't able to answer any of those questions.
那时候刚好全国人民代表大会、全国人大在修改保密法，我也给全国人大写了封信，我提出说这些问题，结果他们没有回复给我，那肯定是不会回复给我。
At that time, the National Party Congress, the government, was changing the law according to classified information, and I explicitly wrote them a letter about it, but they didn't answer me, and of course, they're not going to answer me.
那到现在这个保密法还是没有修改，还是存在，这就是中国可怕之处，随便以什么样的理由，就是国家机密就可以让你失踪，让你被判死刑。
And up until today, this hasn't changed at all, it's exactly the same. And that's very scary because the government can take any reason it wants to control information and to take your books.
所以说这个事情不仅是我作为一个普通的人，我作为一个作家受害，实际上呢官员也受害，大家都知道我们两会刚完就有人已经被失踪了。
So this doesn't only affect me as a normal person or as a writer, this also affects the government and the way that they work.
Thank you. Oneng, I wonder if you've ever been tempted to do anything similarHave you ever felt this level of frustration at the way that the government operates with regard to literature or culture?
I think today, to touch the moral taboos make no sense in China. We have an issue on Hoosper magazine that's about erotic literature. When I started to edit this issue, I wrote about that, but finally it came out with very heavy very heavy taste in Chinese, 重口味, 重口味. I don't know how to say it in English. And, very strong. And actually, today the censorship in China is mainly on political issue. The big challenge for the writer actually is to touch the political taboo. That is not easy in China. I totally don't agree some Excel writers, the Excel literature, Chinese literature, I totally don't agree with them, because 20 years they always used all the course talking about the same topic. They don't care the reality today, the new reality in China, just keeping talking about the old topic, June 4 event, something like that. But actually, there's more important topic now in China to be, the intellectual and writer should be paying more attention to the reality today. So also, the writer or intellectual need to invent a new language and new discourse to express your political opinion. Even though when we promote the free speech, we should find a new way to promote it, not in always in an old way.
So what sort of topics do you think are the really important stories about China that should be written right now?
Yes, I think the urbanization.
Urbanization.
Urbanization and the conflict between the countryside and urban. Because, you know, 30 years ago, the central government started the urbanization politics, and because the economy is very developed very fast, and then the city expand a lot, and then the government need to grab the land from the countryside, and they grab the land and grab the property from the city people also at the same time. So this urbanization process actually is very radical, because it redistributes the social resources, including the land, the property. So it's really radical, more than a revolution. But the Chinese literature scene has no response to this issue. No novel about this. No story about this. I think this is the most important things in the contemporary Chinese history during the last 30 years.
Mm. And so you would say, though, that the greatest challenge that Chinese writers face today is the political challenge, because Chen Xiwo obviously wanted to make a very strong point about censorship and political influence on Chinese literature. Do you think that political censorship is really the greatest challenge faced by writers? And if not, do you think there is a greater challenge?
It's just part of the political issue, it's not the only one. It's not the only one. Actually, like Huska, we still can find some space to speak our opinion, actually. Sometimes not the government censors, it's self-censor sometimes.
You would self-censor?
Not mine, it's my company. They, every issue before the publication, they will have to have some people in charge of reading all the text to see if there are any sensitive topic inside. If they file it and they won't publish, because they won't the magazine keep a long life, they want that investment can, yeah, not banned by the government. This from a business point of view, I think this is reasonable. So I think we should, I want to talk about this. Actually, the Chinese Communist Party it's become very smart, because the new generation join them. They give very good proposal for them. But if you think you are the enemy of the state, sometimes I think that as some dissent, they cannot follow the community party. The community party become very smart, and the dissent still keep in very old idea. I remember this story wrote by Zha Jianying in New Yorkers, talking about her brother. Her brother is the founder of the Chinese Democracy Party. So he thinks he is the enemy of the state. But the Chinese Communist Party, they often develop some new idea, new theory, like harmony society, to control the society, the Chinese society. But the Chinese Democracy Party still keep thinking in a very old way. That is the problem.
Chen Xiwo, and this is the last question I'll ask before I open it up to the floor. You've criticised very openly some of your fellow Chinese writers on the subject of their silence over political issues, for example, over the sentencing of the Nobel Peace Laureate, Liu Xiaobo. Do you think it is the responsibility of the Chinese writer to speak out on social and political and moral issues? Or is a writer just a professional, like a professional tennis player or a professional cook? Should Chinese writers be just left alone to enjoy themselves and make money? For example, in the UK, I don't think that we particularly criticise writers if they are apolitical. I think we admire writers who do take a political stand, such as Salman Rushdie or Don DeLillo, who both spoke out about Liu Xiaobo's sentencing. But as I say, we wouldn't necessarily criticise those who don't take a stand. I wonder, yes, what you think about the social political role of the writer.
最近您批评一些作家，作家是因为他们在政治问题上不会发出他们的声音，比如说刘晓波，他被政府当监制的时候没有人去回应。那么您是否认为作家有责任去说他们对社会、政治和道德的看法？ 或者是作家算是一种专家，像篮球运动员一样，他们只要写好，然后赚钱，然后享受生活那样。我们认为在英国，就是如果作家不会说他们政治看法，就是没问题的。但是如果他们说出政治看法，这也更好。
比如说这个拉士比或者德里洛，他们说出自己的看法。那么你认为，在社会问题、政治问题和道德问题，作家应该怎么说？刘晓波被判刑的时候，北京有一个学者叫邱卫平，他通过打电话的方式，给很多的学者、很多作家打电话，问对这个事情的看法。
At the time when Liu Xiaobo was sentenced, there was a man named Chen Weiping who called a lot of academics and a lot of friends, and he wanted to know their opinion about the issue.
其中有几个作家，我印象中间除了王小利明确表示愤怒之外，其他的人都是态度暧昧。And
very few writers said anything besides Wang Xiaoli, another writer who was extremely angry. The other ones were silent.
有的说不方便说，有的说不敢说，有的说我以后再说，好多年了，这个以后再说这个人现在还没说。Some
said, I'm sorry, it's not convenient to speak right now. Some said they were afraid to speak, they didn't dare to speak. And some of them said, well, I think I'll tell you about it later, but they still haven't said anything.
我一直非常爱艺术，我认为文学是艺术的东西，但是在中国这种情况不太一样，它类似于前苏联。
我一直非常爱艺术，我认为文学应该是属于艺术这一类，但是在中国不太一样，它像前苏联，苏联，前苏联。Oh, I've always thought that literature is part of art. However, in China, it's a little bit different. It's almost like the former Soviet Union.
我记得前苏联很多作家，他们是没有办法去顾及的技术上的问题。 因为他们要首先取得写作上的自由，要自由地发出声音来，这个跟中国作家很类似。At
that time, the writers in the Soviet Union did not have any time to work on their technique. That's because they were spending most of their time fighting for freedom to write anything at all.
很可悲的是，现在大部分的中国作家，特别是体制类作家，他们都以说文学是从文学为理由，而拒绝抗争我们这个不自由的世界。What's
depressing to me is that most writers in China are most worried about writing, and they want to focus on their work, but they don't consider political issues at all.
他们是混淆了中国作家跟英国作家的区别。They're
extremely different from English writers.
哎，在英国可能他不关心政治，他也是一个好作家。他关心政治是更好的作家。而在中国，你如果不关心政治，你可能连作家都不是。In
England, you can be apolitical and still be considered a good writer, or you could be a writer with political opinions, and you might be even more admired for that. But in China, that's the exact opposite of the case.
做出这种的判断，对我来说也是很无奈的，因为我非常爱艺术，但是我现在不得不去做那种跟政治、跟政治抗争的一些事情。At
this point, I feel almost hopeless because I like the art more. I'm more interested in working in literature. However, I must work at fighting against the government and fighting for my freedom.
这是中国作家的特殊命运，我觉得中国特殊情况下的这些真正作家特殊命运。
I think this is a fate that is unique to Chinese writers, and it only happens in this particular political context.
Thank you. Oh Ning, could I briefly turn a question to you before I open questions out to the floor? Could you answer that same question that Chen Xiwo has just addressed?
Yes. The Chinese intellectual often hijack people to be a political people. If you don't participate their politics, then you say you are not a good writer, a good intellectual. This is, I like the situation in the UK. You are free. If you are not interested in politics, you don't need to be so you're interested in politics. But in China, people hijack the intellectual hijack the people to become a political people. Because they do this, they can get some moral subservience. Yeah, subservience. And this is a not good situation. And for my opinion, I have very strong interest in politics, but not the party politics. I don't believe any party. I believe in China, if there's another party, take place of the Communist Party, it makes no sense. So I'm interested in the citizen politics, how the ordinary people protest, how ordinary people participate in the public topic to participate in the politics in an individual, not in a party, in the name of party, in the name of a group. So I think for this opinion, I believe Ai-Wei is a very, very good example.
Thank you. Thank you both of you for answering so interestingly and also frankly, giving us a lot of insights into how what it's like to work in literature in China today. Could I take any questions from the floor, please? This gentleman here.
I wasn't actually going to ask any questions, but your comment about the party getting very smart struck me as very powerfully. I organized a meeting just doing the Tibet business between the head of Human Rights Watch, Ken Roth, and Fu Ying, who at that time was the ambassador here and is now in the foreign ministry. And the point of the conversations, which were conducted privately, were to, in a sense, perhaps amalgamate some a bit with the Western human rights concept. So I heard a great deal of debate about two different kinds of human rights. And I've actually even heard it said by an barrister called Daniel Fung that there's an atmosphere in Beijing a bit like Philadelphia, which sounds a bit extreme. But this smartness, is this purely survivalism by the party, or is there actually an ethical debate? I mean, is there an alternative way of running the world? Because in fact, I think probably there is a kind of worldism going on in Beijing also. Is this smartness of the party, is it actually moving into ethical ground that is interesting in any way to you?
I have an example of how Chinese central government became more smart. During the 2008 Olympic Games, this guy, his name is Gao Zhikai. He used to be translator for Deng Xiaoping, and also he write a lot of articles for New York Times and like that. So before the Olympic Games, he had a proposal for the central government and the Ministry of the Foreign Affairs to teach the Chinese police how to handle the public protests. So he developed a new theory called Yu Gou Li Lun. I'm going to speak in Chinese, that's quite complicated. Could you help me to do this? This Gao Zhikai,
it's
the Yu Gou Li Lun. 就是这个高志凯其实他就是有点像共产党的智囊一样，他呢就是在奥运之前，因为他中央政府担心很多人在北京抗议嘛，在奥运期间，所以他就给了一个建议给外交部和公安部，就是这个建议就是说，以前中国的警察一直分不清那个和平抗议和暴力抗议这两种区别。 不管是新疆烧汽车还是那个在北京挂横幅游行，他都是用同样的办法来处理。
So the new strategy that he proposed was called the fishing canal theory, I guess you'd say. And that's because this person, Gao Zhikai, was almost like the glue for the party at that time. Anyways, before the Olympics, the Chinese government was very worried about protests and they weren't sure how to handle them. So in the past, the police would handle peaceful protests and violent protests in the exact same way. It didn't matter if the protest was in Xinjiang or if it was just people holding banners in Beijing, they would use the exact same methods.
高志凯把那种就是喊口号、拉横幅那种抗议就定义为鱼钩。 把烧汽车那种暴力就命名为那个长矛，这是两种不同的抗议方式。但是中国的警察经常是，你只要上街游行，他就用对付暴力那个方式来对付，所以搞的就是，高志凯认为呢，和平抗议，如果你用镇压暴力的形式去镇压的话呢，就很容易上了这个这些抗议者的钩，或者是上了外国媒体的钩，就可以。 就可以让外国媒体大肆报道中国的人权有多差，所以那个外交部和公安部从此就变聪明了。你游行去吧，就是如果是和平的话，我不会管你。就是所以就是说，就是处理这种冲突的时候，就是共产党其实要很多部分，让它变得更聪明。嗯。
So at that time, this Gao Zhikai, he separated the protests into two kinds. One was called the canal theory, which is people walking around saying slogans and holding banners, so a simple peaceful protest. And the more violent protests were called changmao.
Changmao, a spear.
Okay, so violent with spears. Either you're just fishing or you have a spear. Okay. In the past, they thought anybody on the street is going to be a violent method, is going to be a violent protest. Now they realize that there's two types. And that that basically made the Foreign Relations Department much smarter, because at that time there were some protests that they would just let slide and they wouldn't react at all. And in that way, there's less for the media to talk about, because before that, any time that the Chinese government reacted violently to a peaceful protest, then it would be publicized all over the place and the media would have a lot to talk about.
Another very important book by Mark Leonardo, What Does Chinese Think? I saw on the entrance. It's a very important book to understand the Chinese politics making, because Mark interviewed a lot of Chinese intellectuals who work for the central government. All these intellectuals are very creative intellectuals. They advise the how Chinese handle the business in Africa. They propose to have a 党内民主,
democracy within the party.
Yeah, and this, I think this is very helpful also for the community party. So, just, yes, the, I believe Chinese community party somehow is not that stupid.
Lady at the back.
I'm interested in hearing something about Chinese readers. You know, I was thinking when you were talking about what happened in the Soviet Union, a lot of the texts we know from the Soviet Union days are oppositional texts. Is there, and they were distributed underground in the Eastern Bloc countries, Samizdat stuff. Is there a thirst amongst Chinese readers, do you think, to read texts or read literature that is critical of the status quo?
有点像那个80之前的金线这些地下的杂志这样的。对，地下杂志。对，而且包括一些批评式的杂志。在中国是有杂志，基本上就是它出版基本上是被政府控制的。不被政府控制有一些是民刊，民刊的话呢，小私人民刊还比较多。这个可能就是一些民间的一些力量。
In China, there's a lot of magazines, but they were mostly controlled by the government, for example, Ning and Chen Xiwo. But there were some magazines that were created by just ordinary people.
但是对民间我是比较怀疑的，因为这个中国是一个没有宗教的国家，因此的话，它这个民间它力量的来源，它如果不来源于政府的一些支持、资金的支持啊、地位的支持，它只能够靠自己心灵的力量，而没有宗教这国家，它心灵力量是靠不住的。
But I actually kind of doubted these magazines, and that's because there's no religion in China. Let me explain this. The power of the people usually comes from the government, or it has some kind of government support. If it doesn't have government support, then it has to come from the strength of the individual. However, since China doesn't have a religion, sometimes the strength of the individual is wavering.
因为现在诗人大部分是发表不了作品，我知道有一个杂志在有一年的国庆，就是我们中华人民共和国成立多少周年国庆，举办了一个诗歌专辑，结果的话，写来诗歌来投稿的大部分都是民间诗人，因为对他们来讲，这个是他们发表作品的很好的一个机会。
And that means that most of the time things can't get published. I remember that during the national holiday, that's October 1st in China, there was a magazine that came out and it was going to be a collection of poems and that was going to involve more personal opinions and a lot of writers were excited to write them because they thought it was a special opportunity.
所以很多时候这个民间只是不被主流承认之后被迫流放到民间来。 一旦主流向他招手，他都会找主流上面去。一旦主流向他招手，他马上会接受主流的。So
that's why I don't trust these individuals that are writing because at one point they might say something that's very different or that's against the government, but as soon as they're allowed to be mainstream, they're very happy to be mainstream.
所以百姓能看到真正的。 好的作品，揭示真相的作品，很困难，很困难。Therefore,
the ability for a regular Chinese reader to be able to find good works or to find a work that describes reality is extremely rare. Okay.
时间有限，可以让你提更多的问题。
Okay, he has no comment.
How about internet?
What aspect?
What's the internet effect to the Minjian or the you know unofficial or official?
Right? Sure.
网络有没有影响这个地方呢？网络现在是最好的一个传播真相的一个地方，但是的话呢，很糟糕的是，实际上网络它也是被监控的。比如说在中国国内，很多的网站是上不去的，很多的文章，比如说我本人的文章，到博客上一贴就被和谐掉了，就被删掉了。
I think that the internet is a fantastic platform to get things done. However, the internet is still controlled. Sometimes websites will be blocked. Sometimes I'll write something and put it on my blog, and then that will get blocked.
而且网络上的那些人，有一部分是叫做五毛，就是他们拿着钱，然后在上面散布一些对政府留怨的言论。另外一部分，他们真的是觉得中国已经好了，已经比英国好。
And there are different kinds of people on the internet. Some of them are called the Wu Mao, the Five Pence Party, I guess you could call it. And what they do is they support the government. They always say what the government does is great. Some people suspect that they're paid by the government to say that. Then there's other people that say that the government is great and they truly believe it. They think that China is better than England.
所以我对网络也是有不太敢相信。And
that's why I don't really trust the internet.
I share some very interesting experience for myself. Since the Facebook and Twitter, YouTube was banned in China, so I have to use the VPN to access all these social media. So even though I just arrived in, for example, in Milan. 7 days ago, I keep open the VPN. I don't realize, actually, I already out of the great firewall of China. So, but I really believe the internet can contribute a lot for the political change in China. This is so important. You know, in the Wuhan protests, there's a lot of young guy, they was born in Wuhan, but were in Shenzhen, in Guangzhou. So they went back to the village to participate in the protest, and they using the digital camera to make the video and upload to the Youku, the Chinese YouTube. And then they also have many microblog Weibo to broadcasting their protests. This helps a lot for the protests. Actually, the internet and the new technology, new media is a very important weapon for the citizen protests.
Thank
you. I have a question for Chen Xiwo. I know what you've done have caused you a lot of trouble from the government level, but I'm just wondering, I have a question for Chen Xiwo. I know what you've done caused you a lot of trouble from the government level, but I'm just wondering, what's the reaction from your employer? The university that you are teaching in, they seem to be relatively easy on you, is that right?
我可以用中文吗？我就是有个问题问陈希我知道你做的事情就政府很不乐意哈，但是我想你工作的大学好像对你还比较宽容，是不是这样？
情况是这样子，因为我在大学课堂上，我讲话是比较注意，但是的话呢，我比如打官司的时候就已经有压力了，因为他一些政府部门向我大学通报的事情，然后还有一个我的领导是我的同学，比如说我这次出来的时候，本来要经过审查，说我是不是不准出国的五种人，那我肯定是。 但是的话，我那领导眼睛闭上就给我签了，不是，所以我在这里面还有一定的空间。
Well, I have to say that when I'm working at the university, I'm very, very careful about what I say. Especially in 2007, when I was bringing a case of censorship to the government, I had to be especially careful. But I would say that my employer, or you know, the people that lead me and help me make my decisions, are my students. Censorship had had an effect on my life, and it meant that my travel was controlled. I was put on a list for things that I could and could not do. And so my students gave me money to help me get around this problem. So I would say that actually in school, I have a fair amount of room to do what I would like to do.
我在想说一下，就是我们现就他中国这些官员啊，就包括我顶头上司，还是包括就是更高级别的官员，他们实际上他们不信他们所执行的那一套。我举个例子，曾经我们省，我所在那个省有三位网友因缘获罪被抓进去，因缘获罪被抓进去，当初抗议的时候，我到现场，警察非常多在前面拦住我们。
I'd like to add one more thing, and that's that there's many government officials, some of them maybe local government officials or even higher up, that don't believe in what they're doing. Let me give you an example. There was a case on someone on the internet who wrote something obscene and was it was considered an offense. And I tried to go to attend that case, and the police blocked me from entering the room.
他们并不对我们这些人太凶，他们说的更多的话就是请支持我们工作，我们也要吃饭。They
actually they weren't mean to us at all, and what they said was, please support us in not letting you into the room. We have to eat, you know.
因为他们知道，他们有朝一日他们也会进入抗议的人群中间，这叫做维稳者被维稳。That's
because they know that one day they might be the protesters, or they might have something that they will fight against the government.
所以说，我那些我有不少官员，然后做官做大官的同学，他们对他们所执行的这个制度，他们比我们看得更糟糕。And
so some of my classmates who are hoping to become government officials, they think that the situation is worse. Sometimes it's harder for them.
所以他们千方百计攒了钱，把子女送出去，把自己在国内惹光，甚至藏着护照，有朝一日往外面跑。
And so they have to do a lot of complicated things. Some people will send money to their nephews and nieces so that the money is hiding. Some people hide their passports so that they'll be able to travel.
Gentlemen in the gray jumper.
It seems, listening to you both, that artists in China have different. Sorry, it seems listening to you both that artists in China have different approaches to going about being artists, and we've heard from owning the. Arguing for being savvy and some forward thinking and new ways of being a different and in Chen Xiwo about sort of more perhaps a more old-fashioned approach of straight challenging. And I was wondering how integrated the artistic community is within China. How much do artists coordinate with each other? And do you think actually there would be a stronger movement if artists were able to communicate and synchronize how they were challenging?
Artists, the Chinese contemporary art actually today is very commercial. They never criticize any social issue. Now they just want to make more and more money. They become friends and share the very expensive car, apartment. They don't talk about the political issue today. So forget the artists, forget the contemporary artists. But I believe the more powerful media today in China is the documentary filmmaking. This is very strong movement because there's a lot of individual filmmakers in trying to document everything in China. So they have more close connection with the Chinese reality today. So, but there's not so many opportunities for them to present their film. Whatever in China or outside China. So that is why I, you know, I'm really, I used to be involved in the contemporary art scene, but I feel very tired now. So I'm start a project in the countryside to organize the artist, architect, designer, writer, filmmakers to work together with the farmer in the village. And to develop a new model of how to
how the artists and intellectual can get involved in more deeper in the Chinese society.
Do we have, how many more questions do we have?
Should we
take one more question? Yes,
John. Just to clarify an earlier question. Are Chinese academics writing in academic journals allowed any more freedom of expression than ordinary writers?
I'm sorry, could you please repeat that question?
Chinese academics have more freedom writing in academic journals than Chinese writers.
Mm.
我想问的是中国的学家比中国作家里面更有自由。学者是吗？学者。中国学者如果是真正是中国，他是学者的话，他自由也是非常有限的。当然，跟作家比，作家可能更多时候他更加直面现实。那学者如果是伪学者，他自由是，那当然是可以，他是可以生存下去。
If an academic is strictly involved in just looking at academia, then he's still slightly limited. Maybe writers, they work on more realistic things and they work on things that actually affect modern society. But if an academic solely focuses on academia, then he'll be able to survive. He won't be persecuted.
Last question from the floor, I think.
Can I ask Ning whether he thinks that the subtlety of the Chinese government in their treatment of censorship and the prevalent self-censorship that goes on, whether this is a sign of forward movement, whether if you like, the subtlety is a fake to cover up something that's not changed in 30 years, or whether it actually reflects a change in attitude in the Chinese government moving towards 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, a real freedom of speech.
就是中国政府现在在审查方面更加婉转，可以说，就小步小步的，特别是在审查方面，那么这否意味着是一种进步，还是这想是都是假的？ 就看起来审查是少一点，或者就要不是看起来是少一点，这里没有改变；要不是政府已经有新的态度，以后可能政策也没有。关于中国的审查呢，其实比如说在出版方面，就是有一些
borderline， 就是比如说六四是不能提的。然后提到台湾的时候，一定要注意它不是一个国家，这些就是它有一个关于审查的一个。一个标准，可是呢，各地政府它执行的时候是不一样的。你比如说，在北京，因为作家、艺术家相对多，他那个警力没那么多，他有时候忙不过来，所以感觉在北京那个自由多过广州。在广州的时候，因为就是那几个艺术家，你有些做些什么奇异的举动，他马上警察就来了，就是这样。所以呢。
So in terms of censorship and publication, there's certain things that will be controlled that you just have to be aware of. You can never talk about the Tiananmen Square incident, and you can never say that Taiwan is a country. There are just some standards that everybody knows. However, sometimes things are enforced differently. For example, the Beijing government will enforce things differently than the Guangzhou government. The Beijing government has to watch so many artists and so many writers that some people will slip by. Whereas the Guangzhou government, there's only a few writers, so as soon as one person stands up, the police will run right over and get them. So actually, Guangzhou has less freedom.
但是就在中国很，就是我想说明一个点，就是中国的所谓审查，它最厉害一点就是，它有一种无形的微劣的力量，就是让你当你做本杂志的时候，你很担心出问题，然后你的投资就全部泡汤了，所以你就开始，它厉害就厉害在，它能让你自觉的自我审查，这是中国审查制度最厉害的地方。
But I think that the Chinese censorship is just amazing. It's almost unfathomable. And that's because sometimes the censorship takes a form that you can barely perceive. When you're about to publish something, you have a lot of worries. You're not worried that it's going to work out, and you're worried about a lot of little things. So when the censorship comes up, it's like your brain freezes and it's empty. You don't necessarily use reason anymore. And that's why it's very effective to have self-censorship.
当然这个效果的原因也是因为比如说像今天的场合在国外谈的太多了都是这个 censorship 实际上中国还有很多话题可以谈因为就是这方面谈太多了给某些就是无形加大了他这种威胁的这种力量同时也让可能有些作家觉得要通过 censorship 来吸引外国的注意这是很不好的
Perhaps outside of China, lots of people are talking about censorship all the time. But in China, we talk about a lot of different topics. And what's amazing about censorship is that it's formless, and yet it's still so strong.
最后一句就是它无形增加了它这种威力的力量。然后呢，因为西方的媒体或者是外面的媒体很关注这个，也导致就是很多作家就是通过这种触碰这些审判制度来吸引。
But the interesting thing is, because there's so many Western countries that are interested in censorship, there's more people in China that want to write about censorship so that they can get the attention of Western countries.
I have 1 minute left, and I wanted to ask a question. Well, originally I wanted to ask both of you, but Ning has in fact already answered the question, so I'll just put it to Chen Xiwo. What story or stories about China do you think are the most important ones that writers ought to be bringing out? So what are the really key stories about China that writers should be describing?
就是在现代的中国，什么是最重要的故事？作家应该写，或者是什么故事？我觉得应该写中国人，那中国人如何过正常的生活，过有尊严的生活，这样的故事。The
writer should write more stories about how to live a normal life and how to have a life that you could respect.
比如说我们现在中国人过得很多生活，实际上，是没有不正常的。但是我们因为长期过不正常生活，我们认为说这已经是很正常的。我举个例子，前一段时间，因为我们中国是长期以来是靠，死刑化的器官来移植，来做移植手术的。
One of the problems is that China has spent such a long time, going through life in a way that is strange, that we think strange equals normal. For example, organ transplants is something that we almost think is normal because it's happened for such a long time.
那这本来是很不人道的事情，原来一直政府一直不承认了，现在这次承认了，承认说是这么回事。那这个事件的话，对很多中国民众在中间引起反响，相当一部分的人是认为说这样做是对的，因为那个器官你如果把它烧掉，不如拿来用。
This is an extremely immoral thing, and the government has finally admitted that it does it. But a lot of people have different opinions on it. Some people actually support it, and they say, well, at least the organs are being used.
甚至有的人认为他死生的时候犯罪了，对人民犯罪了，死的时候拿他的器官来用一下是赎罪的。
And then there's some people that say, if it's a criminal whose organs are being used, well, he was a criminal and he was hurting society, but at least his organs can help society.
这种是缺乏基本的一种是非的一种尊严的一种价值观，我觉得这是一个很大的问题。一个中国作家应该更多的来表现这个东西。And
I think that this is completely immoral, and that more writers should consider these kinds of issues.
Thank you very much to both Chen Xiwo and Ning for being so generous with their insights. And understand we're breaking for coffee now, is that right?
Yes,
15
minutes coffee.